said the Leafs would pull off a leafy win tonight?
I seem to recall that, yes.
Next time, shut up.
Let's go!
Do you have a humiliation kick? This is all I ask you to do.
I'm having a great
finger flick.
You're allowed to show up.
This team is ruining my life. I'm taking crazy pills.
With you, wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Leafs
lose 2-1 in overtime at the hands of the incredibly bloody hot Minnesota Wild. How did...
Pardon? I was gonna save this for the questions portion of the video, but let's get it out of the way right now. These Wild fans are out here cocky. Old Blake right here says, how's your season prediction on the Wild aging? Oh yeah? How's your season prediction on the Wild aging? Did you call this? Any of you? Bueller? What are they? 8-2-1? 8-1-2? Whatever it is? They're one of the best teams in the league. Oh yeah, we all called that. Everyone, you know what? I'm gonna put my hand up as the only person who thought a team who didn't even make the playoffs last year wouldn't be very good. This is my punishment. This is my punishment for not putting Marc-Andre Fleury on my goalie Mount Rushmore. This is my punishment.
And honestly, I deserve it. You know what I hate about this? You know what I hate? We finally started talking about the Wild being cool. How they have a chain that just is a plank of wood that says the word hard on it. That's their MVP. Like, the Leafs have the championship belt, right? They have a plank of wood that says hard, which at first I thought might be cringe, and then I decided actually it's dudes rock. And I finally called Minnesota Wild the people's team, and all of a sudden you're giving me crap for it?
No, I am not. No,
I'm upset, to say the least. All right, so there's a few things here. Number one, I had a very busy day today. I was in the car for 5 hours. I drove to London, Ontario from Ajax and from because I had to get home where I live, my house. Oh. That's how easily distracted I am when I shoot videos. I just discovered a whole thing of hockey tape down here. I don't even know what this is doing down here. That's great. I was just running out. Anyway, I drove 5 hours today to London, Ontario and from because we had a book signing in London, Ontario. Did I mention I wrote a book? It's right there above my, here, let me, yeah, there it is, right there. They told me there was something like 240 people who came through the door and I signed books for 4 hours straight because you guys are unbelievable. And unfortunately, I straight up was not able to watch this game because you're not allowed to watch hockey games when you're driving. Someone at the signing was like, yeah, but you could watch it in the car, assuming I was in the passenger seat, assuming someone was driving me home. And I'm like, I don't know what tax bracket of YouTuber that you think I'm in, but it's not that one. Anyway, it was a very long but extraordinarily fun day. Got to meet so many lovely people. I know the Leafs lost and you probably want me to be upset about it. And you know what? I kind of am. I'm not gonna lie, I kind of am. But it's impossible to, I can't shake how happy I am with how many people turned out, how many great stories I heard. People gave me alcohol. I enjoyed that. People spent their time at the store. You cleared the store out. There are no more copies of my book right now at the Indigo North London. At least one person had to go to the Kohl's bookstore across the street, buy my book there, and then walk back into the store because they sold out. It's fantastic. Just unbelievable. Impossible to not be completely chuffed. So I had to listen to the game on the way home. Now, luckily it was a 2-1 game in overtime, so there's not a ton of action to catch up on. And I was listening to all of it and I got to check out what I missed. Was this actually a bad loss upon listening and then later viewing? No, it wasn't. It really was not a bad loss. But after 13 games, the team is now 6-5-2, which is above Bettman 500, but people aren't stupid. It's more losses than wins. They've played 13 games, they've won 6 of them, less than half! And once again, I was going to save this for the question section, but I think it makes sense now, before we actually talk about the bits and pieces of the game. Zach retweets a Sportsnet stats stat, and from last year, after 13 games, the Leafs were 6-5-2. This year, after 13 games, the Leafs are 6-5-2. Identical record. Zach says, this team has had a near identical start each of the last few years. Why are fans seemingly panicking more this year than any other year? First of all, I understand why you feel that way. I also don't necessarily think that's true. You gotta remember, this time last year, like especially after that loss where they got smacked by the Bruins, we did not like this team. We didn't like the moves they made in the summer. We didn't like Klingberg. We didn't like Bertuzzi at first. It wasn't until early-ish, mid-ish November that the team really started to get it together, really started humming and stringing wins together. Just before they went to Sweden, won both games in Sweden, one of them was against Minnesota, came back and kept up that record. But people were really down on last year's team. Why I think people are freaking out about this year's team? It's the same team! Like, okay, I've been very on the record that I think this Leafs team, on paper, to start this season, is better than the team that they started the season with on paper last year. It just objectively is. Chris Tanev, Oliver Ekman-Larsson, and Anthony Stallers alone. It's just objectively true. And up front, if the big guys don't perform, they're dead. They got one goal out of them tonight. One power play goal out of them tonight, which is something they badly needed, and it's not enough. Because you need, typically, more than one goal to win a hockey game. In the same way that on Saturday night, the power play is the reason the Leafs lost that game, everything else is the reason why they lost this one. That and a really dumb play in overtime, but we'll get to that. I'm not going to say I called this, but I did warn about this. 13 games in, Matthews has 5 goals. That's not great by his standard, but we all have faith that he'll, you know, keep going. He'll get better. He'll boost his numbers. Okay, right. Let's say he doesn't. The Leafs did not win the division last year. The Leafs did not finish second in the division last year. They finished third in the division last year. They did not have home ice advantage through the first round. And then Game 7 shows up and they're on the road in Boston again. The Leafs finished third and did not have home ice advantage at home, despite the fact that Austin Matthews went and threw up the single greatest, like by a wide margin, single greatest goal scoring performance of the salary cap era. The best goal scoring performance that we'd seen since the early 90s. He scored 69 goals. Now let's say Matthews, he heats up, right? He's got 5 goals now. Let's say he heats up. Let's say he scores 50 goals this season. That's still an insane season, and he's only hit 50. Has Matthews ever ended a season in the 50s? I don't think he has. I think he's only had 40s or 60s because he's cracked. But let's say he gets 50 goals. 50, on the button. That's great. Objectively, right? Do we all agree, right? He should be one of the highest paid players in the league, right? Okay. That's 19 fewer goals than last year. Tyler Bertuzzi was just allowed to walk. He had 21 goals. That's 40 goals right there. Who did the Leafs get to replace Tyler Bertuzzi? Okay, they got Max Pacioretty, who's been good, like, recently. He's been good. Do we think he's gonna get 21 goals? That'd be killer. For the money they're paying him? That'd be killer. Do we think it's gonna happen? It'd be asking a lot. How about Nick Robertson, who had a really tough game in this one? 15 goals? How are we feeling about 15 goals? Remember we talked about, oh yeah, he's gonna hit 20? How are we feeling about that right now? The problem with the Leafs' offense is it's not that they didn't make any changes. It's that they didn't make any changes, and as a result, it forces them to get players, their star players, to have near historic results again. Let's say Matthews scores 50. Okay, and let's say Nylander scores 50. Hey, that's still a deficit of 9 goals because Nylander had 40 last year. It would only be plus 10. Matthews would be minus 19. Math! Marner could be hotter than last year. Tavares could be hotter than last year, and it still might only be enough to break even. Then you're depending on the rest of the lineup, and I just don't think the talent's there. Robbie's getting killed out there, and that's in the games where he is in the lineup. The solution's not Pontus Holmberg. Max Domi has not been delivering enough after a hot first few games. Matthew Nyes has been a godsend. Bobby McMahon, hopefully he scores some goals. And the fourth line, I'm not even gonna bother asking. So, this feels like I talked about a bunch that's outside of the game, but the game is a symptom of a bigger problem. That's why people are antsy this year. when they struggle in games like this, it's like, well, yeah, that's how they're built. On Saturday, they play pretty well, but the power play can't score, so they lose. This game, they really struggled to pot one, but they got one on the power play, but because they struggled off of the power play, they lose. You had 3 goals over the weekend. 3 goals isn't gonna be enough to win one game on a lot of nights, let alone 2. People are antsy because they're not dumb. I'm not overly panicked personally, I like a lot of what I've seen, but the flaws in this team are agonizingly obvious, and they're going to stay there until they fix them. Maybe help is on the way with Yarncroak, who can score a bunch of goals, Dewar, who scored a bunch with Minnesota last year, but it's a big depth issue up front. Let's talk about the goals. Ryan Hartman just boots the thing in, but apparently it hits Tavares's stick, which makes it fine. So for those of you keeping track at home, you cannot kick the puck in. That's crazy and dangerous. But you can kick the puck out, because that's cool and fine. If you try to kick the puck in and you kick another guy's stick and the stick hits the puck and the puck goes in, that's fine. Get it? No, league doesn't care. Now, the Leafs need to tie this game. It's still the first period. They need to get a power play goal. And they do. And how you feel about this goal says a lot about how you are as a hockey fan. I'm not gonna lie, I kinda hate how I feel about it. Listen, okay, there's glass half full guy. Glass half full guy is like, A, they scored their first road power play goal of the season, actually. And it's a sick pass from Matthews, just through traffic and Nylander, sick shot. Great pass from a great player, great shot from a great player. Elite guys doing elite stuff. We like that 1-1. Can I be a Scrooge about it, though? There have been power plays in recent memory where the Leafs haven't scored, but you're like, all right, they got a bunch of chances. And you're like, eventually those chances are going to go in. This goal that went in is not something that you're going to be able to see all the time. Matthews going across the slot to Nylander or vice versa. Like, yeah, I could see that happening. But not the way that they did it against Minnesota. Like, look at this. Look at the screenshot. Matthews threads it through two wild players, manages to avoid Tavares, and there's another wild player on the other side of the ice. Most players are not going to be able to pull this off most of the time. Most good players are not going to be able to pull this off most of the time. Good thing Matthews isn't a good player. He's a great one. But I wonder what the success rate of a play like that is over the course of 82 games. Glass going back half full. Who cares how they scored it? They scored. They clearly are in their own head. Hopefully they can carry a goal of any kind into the next game and just be fine. Second period, Leafs did a very good job against the Minnesota Wild, but both teams have great goaltending. Filip Gustavsson, Anthony Stolarz, who couldn't hold on to his stick. Anthony, hold your stick! Then we get to the third period, and then Minnesota starts filling the Leafs in a bit. Running around, a lot of possession, a lot of hemming the Leafs in, and this is not all that unsurprising, because the Leafs are on the second half of a back-to-back, and their energy's fading. Second half of a back-to-back that, by the way, 5 p.m. local start after a 6 p.m. local start in St. Louis the night before. For those of you playing the home game, from puck drop to puck drop, from beginning of game to beginning of game, that's 23 hours, and I hate that. Now, wait, it's technically 24 because of daylight savings time, which is cheating. Or is it just a really effective use of time? I'm not sure. But it's something I've talked about for years, where teams back-to-back with travel, less than 24 hours turnover. How is this allowed? Why do teams keep doing this? Or why does the league keep doing this to teams? CJ, Chris Johnston of SDPN, and I think he works for TSN and The Athletic as well, he made a video talking about it because he's a beauty. CJ, what's up with that?
So yes, this was a quick turnaround for the Leafs after playing a 6 o'clock local start game in St. Louis on Saturday, followed by Sunday's game, which started at 5 p.m. local time in Minnesota. And there's a couple things you look at when you answer the question, is this legal? Is this allowed? The first one is 16.7 in your CBA, which covers game times. It says basically no game can be scheduled before noon local time. So obviously that's okay. The next relevant clause to look at in the CBA is 16.8B. And this says that players have to have 9 hours off from when they arrive at the team hotel before the next scheduled activity, be that a morning skate, perhaps a morning meeting. And when we look at the Leafs flight plan, after a 1 hour, 6 minute trip from St. Louis to Minnesota, they arrived at 11:25 p.m. local time in Minnesota. It's about a 16 minute drive from the airport there to St. Paul. Let's assume the Leafs were at the team hotel by midnight, maybe a little bit after. Clearly, that would allow them 9 hours until early Sunday morning where the players could be off. And so, yes, this is a tight turnaround, but it's also fallback, remember. So, you know, those are the relevant things you're considering. But, you know, it's not often that a team will play a game scheduled less than 24 hours after when the previous one was scheduled. But in this case, it is legal.
CJ's such a beauty. So look, obviously the Leafs playing games this close together, or anyone playing games this close together, is fine and allowed. I mean, it's very obvious it sucks. Back to back on the road with travel. Which team are you betting on? It's honestly like kind of commendable and noteworthy that the Leafs got a point out of this. So they survived that third period that doesn't go very well, and they go into overtime. Max Domi intercepts the puck. Great. Advances the puck. Great. Perhaps not that much. Oh, they have it. Oh, he has it. Where are you going? Anthony, no. Wild get a 2-on-0 breakaway in overtime, and they win, because of course they do. Why? Now, Max Domi hits this puck up to himself and just scampers after it. Like, you can hear, like, Bugs Bunny noises as he's trying to get after this thing. And he put it way too far ahead of himself. And too many people are ripping on Domi, okay? Like, he shares some blame here. He definitely shares some blame. But for me, it's a little bit like the Matthews one from against Boston, where, yeah, Matthews ultimately made the really dumb mistake, but there's some blame to go around. Like, okay, look at this right here. Domi is skating after the puck. It's in the neutral zone. There is a Wild player in hot pursuit. Oliver Ekman-Larsson, who is the top Leaf in the screenshot, has already stopped taking strides. He's not even at his own blue line, and it's a long change. That's not great, and that's not helpful. And Max Pacioretty, on the other side, sees everything that's going on. He sees the puck ahead of Domi. He sees Domi. He sees Oliver Ekman-Larsson going off. He's able to see two Minnesota Wild attackers. Okay, so this is like a second and a half later. Dude, it's like the blurry Mr. Krabs meme. What's going on here? Domi shouldn't have done what he did and attacked the way he did. Full stop. Okay? There's some blame. Oliver Ekman-Larsson, obviously dog tired. Perhaps don't. You can see what's happening. Where are you going? And Pacioretty appeared to be joining a rush that didn't exist. Up at the red line? Well, you shouldn't have been bathroom blue line. You didn't see. So, yeah, Domi starts it all off. But, dude, everybody. And now, this is two overtimes where Matthews and Marner, and I think Riley was the other guy. There's a little bit of what are you doing going around for all of them. And on this one, Domi, OEL, and Pacioretty, there's a little bit of what are you doing for them? The first pair of forays into overtime of the Craig Berube era have gone poorly for the Leafs, to say the least. Questions. We've already asked a couple of them. Ooh, how can I get a signed copy of your book sent all the way to Newfoundland? Okay, so, nothing official, but I'm talking to someone. Listen, we sold books. Just me and Jesse filling stuff out. I filled out books. He printed off the slips. We shipped them ourselves. The juice was not worth the squeeze there. We don't have the bandwidth or the resources to do that again. However, it's not official, but I'm speaking to someone who may be able to do this for us. So we'll be able to get books outside of the GTA, books potentially in all provinces, nationally across Canada, books potentially to the States, and potentially non-North America. We're working on it. Let me cook. Lastly, should Stallers be the number one goalie? It's a good question, and the answer that I will come up with is simmer down. The plan long-term is obviously to have Joseph Woll be the starter. I mean, he's signed a three-year extension that doesn't even kick in until next year. Stallers is in year one of two, and he's obviously older. Woll has played, what has he played? Three games? Four, maybe? Coming off of injury? Has he looked like his world-beating self? No. He's been all right. He's been fine. He's been adequate. He's given his team a chance to win in every game he's played. Has the team done that well? Anthony Stolarz, on the other hand, has been incredible. And he was incredible again in this one, dropping the stick aside. If the playoffs started today, unquestionably, Stolarz is starting game one. For sure. But here's the thing. They don't. So there's a lot of games. There's a lot of back-to-backs. These guys are going to split the net. And that's okay. The Leafs are in a great position in net. Don't worry about that. So, man, I'm going to bed. That is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Just take a gander around what's happening on the ice in overtime. It's helpful.